Ladies and gentlemen, this is it. This is the highly anticipated Galaxy Z Flip, the reincarnated slightly smaller brother to the disastrous Galaxy Fold that debuted not too long ago, except this one has a horizontal folding mechanism and is more reminiscent of a Game Boy Advance SP rather than a folding book. Samsung learned their lesson and worked meticulously on the hinge so that trapped dust or debris can't get into the crease and ruin the device. I put a small video of me opening and closing the phone on my Instagram story, and many people's interest spiked. What in the world? A foldable phone? You mean the whole entire screen works despite you being able to fold it? Exactly. The Fold definitely turns heads more than anything, not because of specs or fancy features, but simply its design. Other manufacturers have attempted to make foldable phones a thing, such as Motorola's Razr, and of course the previous Galaxy Fold. But I think Samsung got it right this time. But I think the question is, are foldable phones a gimmick? In practicality, how useful are they? Would you prefer a small portable and foldable phone that you can tuck away just about anywhere, or continue on with our gargantuan tablet-style phones? Well, we're going to take a closer look into that, and so that you can be a more informed consumer and decide for yourself whether the future of smartphones looks like this, or if this is just a fad. Anyway, let's hop straight into the unboxing. And now, jumping into a quick unboxing because the contents here do differ slightly. First, we'll notice that if you order straight from Samsung, the actual shipping box has Samsung branding under the flap, which is a really nice touch. Then, remove the insert holding your phone in place with plastic wrapping to free the box, and we see a very ominous and minimal black box with the letter Z on the front. Almost thought it stood for Zorro, but I forgot this is the Z Flip. Grab your small knife to cut the two clear stickers on the top and bottom. The Z part of the box actually just slides off, so remove it, and now very clever marketing. You now see the front of the actual box says Flip. Get it? First Z, then Flip? On the left is Samsung Galaxy Z Flip branding, nothing on the right or top, bottom is serial number information, and nothing on the back. Lift open the box, and inside on the top portion is your quick start guide, warranty information, a SIM ejection tool, and Samsung was kind enough to give us this clear case of sorts, which is really thoughtful of them. Rarely nowadays do phone manufacturers ever give us any extra goodies. I remember in the past, companies like Apple would throw in so many free accessories, but sadly those days are over. This case will come in handy as the exterior of the Z Flip is a fingerprint magnet. So if you're ever about to commit a crime, leave this phone at home, fam. If you leave this behind at the crime scene like a dumbass, your fingerprints will be found, just a fair warning. Inside the box, we do also get premier service, Galaxy Z Concierge, a full year of complimentary screen repair if something messes up, and our other typical accessories, including your 15-watt adaptive fast wall charger, an OTG adapter to connect this to another device, your USB-A to USB-C cables, and your AKG headset. And that is all we get in the box. Then focus your attention back to the star of the show. Open it up for the very first time, and there it is. Power that baby up, go through the setup, and now experience all of the foldable goodness from your new Samsung Galaxy Z Flip. As you can see, I picked up my Z Flip in mirror black, but can also be picked up in the interesting color mirror purple. The phone retails for $1,380, not cheap by any stretch of the imagination, but I would argue that it is actually an okay price for what you're getting. The fascinating thing about this phone is just how compact it is when folded. When folded shut, the phone measures 3.4 by 2.9 by 0.61 to 0.68 inches, and when completely open, measures in at 6.6 by 2.9 by 0.28 inches. Eerily similar to almost the exact size of the S20 Ultra. It also weighs only 6.5 ounces, or 184.2 grams. Just for comparison, if any of you guys own the iPhone 11 Pro Max, that dude weighs in at 7.34 ounces, or 208 grams. The small form factor and lightweight design is definitely a huge perk for me. But now, going over a very quick tour as it is customary on this channel. When folded down at the bottom, we have our tiny 1.1 inch AMOLED display, which displays useful information as well as act as a viewfinder for taking selfies. our flash module, and our two 12 megapixel sensors. On the right side, we do have our volume rocker as well as our power button, which comes integrated with a fingerprint sensor, as this phone doesn't have the embedded fingerprint scanner that can be found on the likes of the S20 or S20 Ultra. Over on the other side, we have our new and improved hinge with Samsung branding, and our SIM tray is located on the left side as well. Down at the very bottom is our USB-C port to charge and sync the device, a microphone, and our speaker grill. And opening it up, the placement of some of our buttons remain on the same side, just now higher up since the phone in essence is now longer. We see our crease right in the middle, that at first is a bit obtrusive, but much like with notches, after a day it just blends in. At the very top is our 10 megapixel selfie camera, along with the top speaker primarily used for making phone calls. So of course, ultimately, the Samsung Galaxy Z Flip has been designed to grab people's attention. It's not so concerned about specs or the fanciest cameras. I think Samsung's intentions with the Z Flip were to test a niche market. You know, dip their toes into these waters with a fully functional folding phone with so far minimal problems, and see if it sells well, or better yet, if the smartphone market steers into the way of foldable phones. The allure of this phone is simply spectacular. Instead of a plastic screen like other manufacturers have tried before when making foldable devices like these, Samsung opted for using an ultra-thin layer of glass, and the results are well worth it. This makes the device feel extremely sturdy to hold. It feels well-made, durable, very good construction, and when folded away is tiny enough to tuck away just about anywhere, your pockets, purse, or your gym bag. That wasn't necessarily the case with the previous Galaxy Fold, which when opened up like a book, revealed a 7.3-inch display. I like this flip phone design way better. It takes me back more than a decade when everyone had those Motorola flip phones that I desperately wanted but could never get because my parents thought I wasn't responsible enough for a phone. The phone lays flat and has absolutely no bumps or anything on the screen, just that noticeable crease down the middle. What's best is, the hinge allows you to operate the phone like normal despite the phone not being completely folded out, meaning, the hinge doesn't necessarily have a lock-in-place-to-use mechanism to speak of. No sound or any mechanical clicks are made when opening up the phone, which results in the user being able to view content and operate the phone at a 90-degree angle, 120 degrees, or even 15 degrees. It's pretty cool. There are even some software integration to this. For example, open up the camera app while the phone is halfway unfolded, aka at a 90 degree angle, and the top portion turns into your viewfinder, and along with even more options for you to tweak your pictures, including camera settings, a timer, which allows for hands-free pictures, and is a super dope feature to have on this foldable design, and a lot of other things. I guess the thing that really made all of this possible is the newly redesigned hinge, which Samsung put countless hours to perfect to make this as durable as possible. You see, having a foldable screen by nature means the phone's display is automatically less durable than your traditional flat glass panels. In case you've been living under a rock, the previous Galaxy Fold that was initially released was met with heavy and intense criticism from tech reviewers. Not me, sadly, because my channel's too small to be sent test units early. Not salty or anything, but anyway. The construction of that hinge in essence allowed for dust and debris to get caught, not only in the hinge mechanism, but ultimately on the crease of the plastic display found on the previous Galaxy Fold, resulting in screens getting battered from just a few openings because of these pieces of debris. The Z Flip's hinge has a thin layer of fabric, designed to keep all dust and debris away from the small gap in between the screen and hinge that would otherwise ultimately find their way to the display or mess with the hinge mechanism, and so far, it's worked flawlessly. After having the phone for about a week, I have yet to encounter any problems with the Z Flip's hinge and foldable mechanism, and from what I can see from other reviewers, neither have they. This time, the hinge has many improvements and makes opening the phone a breeze. Maybe not one-handed operation. Definitely still open it up with two hands just to be on the safe side, as it's quite finicky to try and open with one hand. But the best part is, Samsung is really confident with this new design, and with the all-new ultra-thin glass that the display houses, Samsung says the phone should be good for flipping open 200,000 times. That's a pretty bold claim, because realistically, how many times do you think you'd flip open the phone? Like, come on, realistically, at most, if you're a super heavy user, maybe 200 times. But for the average user, maybe 100 times. Meaning, at 100 flips a day, the phone's display should be good enough for 2,000 days, or about 5.5 years. Not bad if you ask me. So now that we have discussed the main differentiating factor that sets this phone apart from others, let's go to the nitty-gritty and discuss specs, and to be quite honest, this phone isn't about specs. That's not what Samsung was worried about at all. In all honesty, I'm glad this and others like the Motorola Razr exist because you see, in my opinion, smartphone designs have gotten so stale over the past years. They're all the same. A huge slab of glass that treads dangerously close into tablet territory with enormous glass displays. They all find their own way to make their stupid notch unique. All are that rectangular brick form factor. Like, you know what I mean? So it's really nice to have something new and refreshing, and that's precisely why this phone has inferior specs as compared to its also newly released cousins, the S20, the S20 Plus, and the S20 Ultra. It sports a last generation chipset, but is by no means years behind. It is still a very powerful and capable phone. Inside, it sports the Snapdragon 855 Plus, 8GB of RAM, a base storage configuration of 256GB that is not expandable. I mean, at least I don't see any microSD card slots anywhere on this phone, and a 3,300mAh battery. But for a foldable display, Samsung didn't hold back. When folded out, it has a gorgeous 6.7-inch Super AMOLED display with that ultra-thin glass good for a screen resolution of 2636 by 1080 pixels. When closed, you'll notice we have another tiny mini display, a 1.1-inch Super AMOLED panel that can be found on the exterior to the left of the cameras. And as mentioned, it's not just there for show. It does a lot of great useful things like showing you the time, date, battery percentage, alarms, show you incoming text messages and phone calls, but arguably the best feature of this mini display is that you can use it as a viewfinder to shoot selfies with the phone closed. Obviously, it's not a huge display, so it kind of defeats the purpose. I wasn't so sure how useful this tiny screen was, but man, taking selfies with the closed phone on the small viewfinder for some reason just feels right. Definitely has you feeling like you're living in the future with your foldable phone, taking selfies on a 1-inch display. What a time to be alive, man. To do so, just press the power button twice while having the phone closed and press any of the volume buttons to take that insta hit that will net you 1,000 likes easily within the first 2 hours. But while we're on the topic of cameras, I guess this is a good time to brush up on them, but we won't take as long as the S20 or S20 Ultra, as the cameras here aren't necessarily as good as its cousins. This phone features two cameras on the exterior of the top half, that being a dual 12 megapixel pair of a standard wide lens at f1.8 and an ultra wide sensor at f2.2, along with a 10 megapixel front facing camera in the center at the top instead of off to the side or something silly like that. Noticeably absent is that super powerful telephoto sensor, but weirdly enough, I'm okay with that. The Z Flip takes pictures perfectly fine, but it would have been nice to have that telephoto sensor. It records video just fine as well, but only up to 4K resolution at 60fps, unlike the S20 and S20 Ultra that can record in 8K resolution, but the photographs turn up just fine and even in low light performance. The front-facing camera is just what you'd expect from your standard 10 megapixel selfie camera. Great for taking the occasional selfie, but otherwise, the standard stuff. As far as battery, I think this is an area of improvement for Samsung because that battery packing 3,300mAh is relatively small when you compare the phone to its display size to battery size ratio. For comparison, the S20 Ultra has a 6.9-inch Quad HD AMOLED display and packs an enormous 5,000mAh battery, while this Z Flip sports a 6.7-inch display with a 3,300mAh battery. Sure, the S20 Ultra packs way more of those impressive 2020 features like the 120Hz refresh rate, the super crisp Quad HD display, a faster processor, but being the Snapdragon 865 versus the Snapdragon 855 Plus found on the Z Flip and the S20 Ultra, just like the S20 line, does support 5G, while the Z Flip is limited to 4G LTE. It may sound like I'm bashing on this poor guy, but honestly, the specs on this device are just perfect for your average user. What you'll get when purchasing the Z Flip is a truly unique experience and not one focused on the best specs. I understand with a newer concept like with these foldable phones, it's hard to also design a huge battery to go along with the intricate design of the phones. I just feel the 3,300mAh battery isn't enough, and just from playtesting, the Z Flip lasts me much shorter when compared to the S20 line. I guess we'll have to see how it fares when we pit it up head-to-head against the other phones in my infamous battery drain test coming up real soon. I really have so many videos planned for this new line of Galaxy phones. They're also interesting in their own unique way. There's just so much to say about the Galaxy Z Flip, I barely hit the tip of the iceberg. We could talk about the cameras, the foldable design more in depth, the specs, but Samsung learned so much from the previous Galaxy Fold and made improvements accordingly, but I wonder how it'll fare after having it for the next couple of weeks. I plan to do a full complete 2020 Galaxy buying guide, as well as a head-to-head video comparing the S20 Ultra to the Z Flip since they're both priced in that ultra premium category, with both costing well over $1,500 after tax. So in conclusion, what can I say? I love the Z Flip. It's unique, it's different, a breath of fresh air, but absolutely not perfect. The design for sure is the attracting factor. It's similar to how the baboon uses his big bright red ass to attract a mate. It's just eye-catching. Not the baboon's butt, I meant the Z. You know what? Anyway, the design is what brings you in, and while not having the top-of-the-line specs or even the best cameras, it gets by with just enough to be viable in 2020. I love how easily and fluid the hinge mechanism works, and just how small, compact, and portable the Z Flip is when completely folded. And even at $1,380 for what it is, it's honestly not badly priced, way better than the almost $2,000 MSRP the previous Fold was released at. In comparison, you get a much more solid, better constructed phone with decent specs overall, but more importantly, a much more durable and reliable phone. What do you guys think? Is this going to be a trendsetter? Are foldable phones the future, or is this just a fad just like Pokemon Go was? Let me know in the comments below. I can't wait to bring you guys more of this Galaxy content, and we'll see what happens with the now rumored to be canceled Apple March event, all thanks to coronavirus. Way to go, man. I just want my tech. Anyways, take care of yourselves and each other, and I'll catch you all in the next one. Peace out, my dudes.